Hey family, it's Pastor Phil. Listen, I'm so excited to be here with you all and share this word. You know, we've been on what? Emotional detox, and hopefully the word has been reaching you at the point of your need. You know, the reality is that during this COVID, during this, pandemic, during this voting season with, unemployment so high, folks not sure where the next meal is coming from, emotionally, we really need to just detox from all of the crazy emotions that can run through here, through our mind, right? And so I've been sharing from the Word of God to try to encourage, and hopefully, dealing with worry, dealing with anxiety, dealing with fear, dealing with all of those emotions that if we're not careful could really mess us up. So today we're actually going to come out of Ephesians chapter 4, right? And we are going to talk about angry words. Angry words. The Bible says be angry at immorality, at injustice, at ungodly behavior, yet do not sin. Do not let your anger cause you shame, nor allow it to last until the sun goes down. And do not, verse 27, and do not give the devil an opportunity to lead you into sin by holding a grudge or nurturing anger or harboring resentment or cultivating bitterness. Verse 29 says, do not let unwholesome, foul, profane, worthless, vulgar words ever come out of your mouth, but only such speech as is good for building up others according to the need and the occasion, so that it will be a blessing to those who hear. And I got to get to verse 30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, but seek to please him, by whom you were sealed and marked, branded as God's own for the day of redemption, the final deliverance from the consequences of sin. There's a lot in here. And we're just going to try to take our time. So it is called angry words. You remember when the phone apps were coming out crazy, and there was this game out called Angry Birds. And, you would launch the birds, and the birds would fly across the thing and destroy, buildings. And the more buildings you destroyed by the birds, right, the more points you would rack up, and then you would move to the next level. Angry words are just like angry birds. They're like bricks thrown, and the words that we speak can have a determinative effect on people's life. And so I want to encourage you today, as we walk through this passage of scripture, to really think about anger, where it comes from, how it affects you, how it impacts your life, how it impacts your family. There are three types of anger which help show how we react in situations that make us angry. These are passive aggression, open aggression, and assertive anger. If you are angry, the best approach is assertive anger, because it's appropriating your anger correctly. Many don't like to admit that passive aggression, that they are angry because they don't like confrontation. This is called passive aggression. This comes out in things like becoming silent when you're angry, sulking, procrastinating, putting stuff off, and pretending everything is fine. You've heard the words passive aggressive. In other words, internally you're angry, but because you don't want to confront the situation, you find a way to put on a happy face, but at the same time you're boiling on the inside. Now that's dangerous, because ultimately what's happening is you're causing your internal cognitive temperature and clock to be way off, and so you end up building up stuff like high blood pressure, hypertension, right, when you're passive aggressive, because it's like shaking up a Coke bottle, nothing is able to get out, but then when it finally comes out, you end up blowing up. The second one after passive aggression is open aggression. Many people have a tendency to lash out in anger and rage, become physically or verbally aggressive, and can oftentimes hurt themselves and hurt others. This is called open aggression. This comes out in fighting, bullying, blackmailing, accusing, shouting, bickering, cussing folks out, sarcasm, criticism. Some of y'all know some open aggressive folks. Maybe some of y'all are openly aggressive folks, just haven't been able to learn how to really appropriate your anger, and so you end up lashing out at people with what? Angry words. Angry words can hurt. Angry words sting. Angry words impact. Angry words tear down. Angry words destroy. Angry words cut. And so many a times, a lot of times when our anger comes upon us, come on, we are openly aggressive with those words. We're punching people in the mouth, but we're not hitting them with our fists. We're hitting them with our words, and we're cutting people down, and we're tearing them down. Husbands, let me tell you something that will bless your whole life. Listen, you need to remember never to call your wife out of her name. You need to remember to only speak words to her that are going to build her up, and vice versa. Ladies, you need to be able to do the same, because here's the reality. Come on, you can kill with your words and you can give life with your words. Jesus said that, watch this, we have to learn, according to Ephesians 5, which is the next chapter, how to wash our wives in what? The word of God. Why? Because when we wash them in the word, we present them to ourselves, a bride, come on, that is shining and glowing and beautiful. Now, the third type of anger is assertive anger. The healthy way to deal with anger is by being controlled and confident, talking and listening and being open to help in dealing with the situation. This assertive anger can help relationships to grow. It means thinking before you speak, being confident in how you say it, yet open and flexible to the other side. In other words, anger is not bad, but you've got to learn how to manage your anger. Come on, so that anger doesn't overthrow you, watch this, and cause you to do damage and harm to people you love, and sometimes, watch this, to yourself. I'm going to talk to you about the cognitive reality of what happens when you get angry and how anger can mess you up. So I'm going to give you this picture of my fist. This is like a picture of the brain, right? And on the top here is what they call the cerebral cortex. On the top of your brain is the cerebral cortex, and the cerebral cortex is where your rational thinking comes from. It's where you make your rational decisions. On the bottom of your brain is called the limbic system, and the limbic system is where your emotional decisions come from. And then, of course, there's the amygdala. And the amygdala is the thing that senses trouble, right? And senses, danger, and senses rejection and all the other things that could potentially harm you. And so when you are in that place and anger is getting ready to happen, anger happens when the amygdala senses something ain't right and I've got to protect myself. So what happens is the amygdala shuts down the cerebral cortex. And then all of your thinking happens here on the bottom of your brain, which is the limbic system. And that's when, have you ever heard the terminology called flipping your wig? Essentially, when you flip your wig, you stop thinking with the top of your brain and you start moving from an emotional perspective. And what happens is the amygdala says, you ain't gonna get over on me. You're not gonna harm me. Come on, you're not gonna treat me like they treated me. And it sends a message and it says, shut down reasoning. Come on, and start operating from your emotions. It releases adrenaline and cortisol and all this other stuff, these hormones in your body, come on, that cause you to be strong. Why? Is you're getting ready for fight, flight, or freeze. And so what happens when anger comes, think about the last argument you were in and you were so angry, come on, that you said some stuff that you ended up having to take back, or you had to end up going to apologize. It's because your rational thinking got shut down. You flipped your wig and you started spitting out and saying things that you weren't supposed to say, maybe doing things, throwing over tables, breaking plates, and all that other kind of stuff. Why? Because, watch this, you stopped thinking rationally and you ended up thinking from your limbic system, from the bottom of your brain, watch, from an emotional perspective. And that's what happens when you get angry. And God says, I love God, because he's like, you know what? It's all right to be angry. Just don't let your anger push you to sin. Now let's get to the word. So when your limbic system overrides your cerebral cortex, they call that amygdala hijack. In other words, when you get into that angry place, your reasoning has been hijacked by the amygdala. And what happens is you're filled with all of these, hormones that are causing you to go off, right? And really, many a times, it's not even about the person. It's about how you're feeling. You're feeling threatened. You're feeling rejected. You're feeling, lonely. You're feeling like, maybe someone did something to disrespect you and the anger came up. But remember, when you're angry, you're not thinking with your rational brain. You're thinking from your limbic system. You're thinking from your lower nature. And what happens is you end up, watch this, becoming an aggressor. And you can say things and do things, come on, that you do know that words are like arrows shot from a bow. And once you say them, you can never take them back. That's why we need to emotionally detox. So we're going to take a few moments. We're going to take a few moments and walk through this place. And I know sometimes when you get angry, people say, you know what? You need to count to 10. Just go ahead and count to 10 and you'll be fine. Let me tell you something that is going to hopefully inform you. But guess what? When you get to that place of anger and when that amygdala, you know, communicates and hijacks the cerebellum and the cerebral cortex, essentially what happens is those hormones get released in your body. And guess what? It stays in there for 20 minutes. So even though you walk around and you count to 10, that's why my dad, I understand now what he said. When him and my mom would get into a heated argument, he would just go out and feed the pigeons. They lived in Harlem, so he would just go sit on the bench and feed the pigeons. Me, I would get in the car and just go for a drive. Right? You got to be able to walk away from those situations, because in those situations, you're not talking rational. In those situations, you're talking straight emotion, and that emotion can be dangerous. And so the scripture says, watch this, point one, it's all right to be angry. If God gave you the ability to be happy, and he gave you the ability to be sad, and he gave you the ability, you know, to have joy, and he gave you the ability, right, to work, like all of that, your emotions are okay. He says, don't resist the reality that you have been given this amazing capacity that you can be happy, you can be sad, but you can also be angry. The key is not to let your anger control you. The key is to not allow your anger to drive you into being, look at what it says, be angry. But here's what you should be angry at. Be angry at sin, at immorality, at injustice, at ungodly behavior, yet do not sin. Don't let your anger, listen, cause you shame, nor allow it to last until the sun goes down. In other words, what God is saying is you got to put some boundaries around your anger. Right? You've got to be intentional about not allowing that anger, come on, to cause you to harm people you say you love. But remember, when you get into that place of anger, you're not thinking rationally anymore. You're thinking from your lower brain. And so what happens is you end up injuring people you say you love. Baby, I love you. But in my anger, come on, I smack you. And the problem is with that we end up harming people. See, anger is an emotionally toxic thing if it is not handled appropriately. I love the word of God because it said, don't let your anger cause you shame, nor allow it, watch this, to last until the sun goes down. Don't let your anger cause you shame. Essentially, what is being intimated here by the Apostle Paul, listen, is that you and I will, if we allow anger to control us, it will ultimately bring us shame. What is shame? I've done wrong, right? I'm sorry, guilt is I've done wrong. Shame is I am wrong. Right? And the reality is that if you are controlled by your anger, you will end up shaming yourself, right? You will end up causing yourself to fall. You will end up falling back. And I don't know about you, but there have been times when my anger has gotten me in trouble. Right? It says, nor allow the sun to go down. In other words, really what God is saying, come on, is don't continue in anger. You get that. He's saying don't continue. Don't allow it to carry on into the evening and over into the next day. Husbands and wives, you got to find a way. Let me encourage you and significant others. You've got to find a way to forgive each other quickly. Don't walk around the house for 3 days and a week being stubborn and not talking to one another and bumping into one another and not saying anything, just being cordial. No, you've got to learn how to let it go. Forgive, watch this, so that anger does not cause you to shame. It does not drive you to shame, nor don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Secondarily, watch this, don't let your anger cause you to sin. You got to remember that when you are angry, you're utilizing, you heard me say it, the limbic system. Psalms chapter 4, verse 4, tremble with anger or fear and do not sin. Meditate in your heart upon your bed and be still. Reflect upon your sin and repent of your rebellion. David says, Selah, like pause for a minute. In other words, on your bed, listen, meditate in your heart on your bed and be still. Don't allow that anger to cause you, watch this, to fall in to a deeper level of sin, to fall in to shame, to fall in to guilt, to fall in to hurting folks. Now I want to move to verse 27. Look what verse 27 says. Watch this. Here's the next point. The wrong type of anger lets the devil in. Let me show it to you in the Bible. Ephesians 4:27. And do not give the devil what? An opportunity to lead you into sin by holding a grudge or nurturing anger or harboring resentment or cultivating bitterness. Good God. In other words, what Paul is saying, watch this, is that when we give anger an opportunity to last and to stay with us and to control us, literally what we're doing is we're giving the enemy an opportunity. We are opening the door to our spirit. We're opening the door to our life. We're opening the door to me. Watch this. And then when the door is open, the enemy comes in, watch this, to try and destroy you. In other words, he will allow anger to cause that anger to turn to rage and that rage to turn to murder. And before you know it, come on, your life is destroyed because of your anger. Your family is impacted because of your anger. Your children, come on, are impacted because of your anger. You lose your job because of your anger. Anger, come on, the Bible tells us anger lies in the belly of a fool, that if you allow anger to rest in your belly, come on, it means that you are foolish and not walking in the wisdom of God. Yeah, it says, look what it says, to lead you into sin, and don't give the devil an opportunity to lead you into sin by holding a grudge. How many of y'all got some grudges out there? Huh? I know there's some grudge holders. It says by holding a grudge or nurturing anger. You know what it means to nurture something? It literally means that you take care of it. You invest in it. You let it grow up. You give it what it needs to be able to be expanded. And this is the reality and the revelation of the truth. In other words, he's saying don't give the devil the opportunity. Watch this, by nurturing your anger. Sometimes, listen, you got to destroy that anger. You've got to not let that anger control you. It says what? Don't nurture your anger or harboring resentment. To resent somebody, come on, means to have an offense against them and to dislike them and maybe even to go to hating someone. And you know that is not the work of the Spirit. My God, that is the work of the flesh. He says don't harbor resentment. When you harbor something, it means you live in that space. You allow that resentment to live in you. It takes up residence in you. He said don't give the devil an opportunity by harboring resentment. Who do you need to forgive today? Who do you need to release? Who has offended you? Come on, that you're harboring that resentment, that anger, come on, is building up in you. And what I'm here to tell you and to encourage you today, according to the word of God, is you need to know you're giving the devil an opportunity, come on, to come in and to steal your joy. You're opening yourself up, come on, so he can steal your faith. Come on, it's hard to worship the Lord and walk around angry. It's hard to give him glory, come on, and you're walking around angry. It's hard, come on, to love somebody and you're walking around angry all the time. The problem is, where is your anger coming from? We'll talk about that in a minute. Look at what Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 9. It says, do not be eager in your heart to be what? Angry. Don't be eager in your heart to be angry. And I would submit to you, come on, if you are a person who is always angry, come on, I would submit to you that you've been hurt somewhere. And because that hurt was never resolved, the response to that hurt, come on, is that I walk in anger so I can, number one, make sure nobody's going to hurt me again, come on, and not address that unaddressed, come on, hurt then manifests itself in different ways, different manifestations. And people who are hurt, watch this, end up hurting people. People who are hurt have to find ways to cope with that hurt. And so one of the ways is the expression of anger, because now I'm inflicting the pain on you that I'm feeling in my own heart. And the reality is, come on, that God wants to deal with that anger. And some people who are angry weren't born that way. People weren't born angry. Come on, they've been inflicted. They've been offended. They've gone through something. And because of what they've gone through, come on, that then, if it is unresolved, will manifest itself in how you treat somebody else. Because hurting people, come on, want people to hurt with them. And so people are being inflicted, words are being said, angry words are being tossed around a household or on a job or in a playground, right? And it is those words that can hit you at the heart of your soul. And this word says, Ecclesiastes, don't Be eager in your heart to be angry, for anger, watch this, dwells in the heart, and in the KJV, in the belly of a fool. In other words, at the very foundation, at the very core of a fool, you will find anger. This is God's word. This is not me. If you fill your life with resentment, if you allow guilt to turn into shame, Satan has a foothold in your life, and you've got to be careful, because you know, according to the book of John, that the enemy has an intensive plan against the believer. You know, come on, according to 1 Peter chapter 5, come on, that he's prowling around looking and seeking whom he may devour. And so the word tells us that if I got anger in my heart, I'm giving him an opportunity. He doesn't have to look for somebody else. Why? Because my anger is opening the door for him. And watch this, when you're angry, my God, when you're angry, sometimes and many times you find other ways to cope with your anger. In other words, now I've got anger going on, I'm not thinking rationally, I'm moving emotionally, and now, watch this, things that God has delivered me from, come on, I end up running back to, because what? I got to deal with this anger, and the only way I'm going to be able to deal with this anger is to go do this or go do that. I need to escape from the moment that has caused me to go up in my anxiety, up in my rage, and up in my wrath. Come on, and I've got to find a way to escape. And so you see what happens, the door gets open to the enemy when you walk in anger. And when the enemy comes in, come on, he's not just satisfied, come on, with a moment. He wants your life to be on a slippery slope on the way down. You have to allow, watch this, you have to allow guilt not to turn into shame. And you've got to allow to make sure that the enemy does not have a foothold in your life. This is what the Bible says. It says that when you walk in anger, you give him an opportunity. And all you need to know is that's all that devil wants. He wants an opportunity. That means that when I'm walking in peace, there's no opportunity. That means that when I'm walking in grace, there's no opportunity. That means that when I'm walking, watch this, in love, there is no opportunity. In other words, when I'm walking in the fruit of the Spirit, I am, watch this, protecting myself, come on, from the infiltration of the enemy into my soul. You know, the scripture says that the enemy comes in like a flood, come on, but the Spirit of God comes in and raises up a standard against him. I'm trying to tell you that you got to watch out for anger. Watch this. And you got to watch out for angry words. I really like that game, Angry Birds. I don't know why. I guess it was a fad for a moment. Nobody plays it anymore. But it was the idea of being able to launch something and watch what I launch strategically destroy what it hit. And there was, I guess there was something in me that moved me that I had the power to destroy something on the other side. You see, it's just like that when you're angry. When you're angry, come on, what happens is you let angry words come out. And those angry words that come out, watch this, have the ability to destroy what it hits. Sometimes it hits your kids. Sometimes it hits your spouse. Sometimes it hits your family. Sometimes it hits your coworkers. Sometimes it just hits random people. Have you watched the TV lately? There's some angry voters that are out there on one side and on the other side, or Democratic or Republican, and their anger is just so, like, where's all this hate coming from? In fact, hurtful words can haunt you all of your life and may lead, specifically when it's children who receive hurtful words. There's a recent study that said that, watch this, revealed that those individuals reporting experiencing verbal abuse from their peers during middle school years had underdeveloped connections between the left and right sides of their brain through the massive bundle of connecting fibers called the corpus callosum. Psychologist tests given to all subjects in the study showed that this same group of individuals had higher levels of anxiety, depression, anger, hostility, disassociation, and drug abuse than others in the study. In other words, kids who receive negative reinforcement and negative words in their middle school years manifested in stuff like depression, anxiety, drug abuse, hostility, and disassociation. And so you don't even understand, come on, that just an idle word to your child, you're dumb, you're stupid, why didn't you figure that out? Why didn't you do that? You're lazy, you're irresponsible, right? These angry angry words have an impact and they don't bounce off. Yes, sticks and stones can break my bones. I don't know who came up with that, but words can hurt and words do hurt and words tear down. You see what the word of God said? He said, be angry, but sin not. He said, don't let any filthy or corrupt communication come out of your mouth, because you never know who is in the locale of the words that you speak. And it's a reality. Words hurt and can haunt you all of your life and may lead to all of these other things, right? Imagine the young man who walks into a middle school and goes in and kills people in Colorado because he was teased, or goes into a movie theater and shoots up a movie theater because he was rejected by people. Imagine the hurt and the harm, come on, that people have inflicted because they had that open aggression. They did not know how to process the anger that was coming out of them. I love the word of God, because in Colossians chapter 3, verse 8, it says, but now you also put them all aside: anger, wrath, malice, slander, abusive speech from your mouth. In other words, as children of God, listen, we've got to learn how to identify the source of our anger. And I'm going to get to that in a minute. We've got to learn how to not let anger control us. We've got to identify it, and we can't let it control our life. We can't. Because as children of God, the scripture says that we should speak blessing. What comes out of our mouth should be positive. How we declare the word of God and how we live out our life, watch this, should now then be a blessing to others. And I love this. In verse 29, it says, don't let any unwholesome, foul, profane, worthless, vulgar words ever come out of your mouth. But only such speech is good for building up. Hold up. Wait a minute. God says, stop cussing and start blessing. He says, let the words, as a child of God, let the words that come out of your mouth not be unwholesome. Don't let the pond be filthy, but let it be something, come on, that is going to shed life. That what comes out of your mouth, come on, should be a building. It should be edifying. That your words should be things like building blocks. Come on, you should be able to build people up with what you say. I'm in the book. It's in verse 29. He says, but only such speech is as good for what? Building up others according to the need and the occasion, so that it will be a blessing, not a cursing, to those who hear. In other words, your words now, your words have constructive power. It's like if I had blocks here, watch this, that as I spoke, come on, I would be building something up. In other words, but if I had blocks here and I was speaking negative, it's like I'd be tearing down what was built by God. And the reality is that we have to understand there is power in what we say. There is power in how we communicate. I love the fact that he says, listen, in verse 30, and do not grieve the Holy Ghost, but seek to please him, by whom you were sealed and marked, branded, watch this, as God's own for what? The day of redemption. In other words, he says that when we let corrupt communication come out of our mouth, when we are profane, when we walk in anger, when we are tearing folks down, it says that we are grieving God. It hurts the heart of God. Come on, when we who have been redeemed and who have been blessed, blood bought, come on, and forgiven, when we walk in anger and when we walk in these toxic emotions, essentially, watch this, essentially, it grieves the Holy Spirit. It doesn't mean God is not God. It just means that it hurts the heart of God when those who have been purchased. It says you're sealed to the day of redemption. You've been filled by the Holy Spirit, and you listen, as a child of God, hurt the heart of God when you walk in anger, unforgiveness, bitterness, wrath, anger, and rage, that if you're not careful, come on, you can say you're a child of God, but yet still grieve the heart of God. It seems antithetical to the purpose that we've been called to be like Jesus and to walk this earth. I'm trying to encourage somebody today. It's time for you to deal. Listen, it's time for you to deal with that anger in your heart. It's time for you to address that stuff in your heart. Look at verse 31. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor, perpetual animosity. Hold up. Wait a minute. He said, you got to get rid of that perpetual animosity. You know what that means? Everybody's wrong except for you. You're playing the victim all the time because you want to be mad. You think if people, you know, are out to get you and don't like you and all that fool, he says, get rid of perpetual animosity. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor. And I like this. He put it all together, because when you're bitter, you'll move to wrath. And when you're wrath, you'll move to anger. And when you're angry, you'll start clamoring and start talking about folks. Watch this. And that's perpetual animosity, resentment, strife, and fault finding. My God, let it all get away from you, and slander be put away from you, along with every kind of malice, all spiteful verbal abuse and malevolence. God is saying, listen, here's something for you. You got to get rid of this stuff, because if you don't, ultimately, back to the original scripture, sin will take you down. He said, don't let the sun go down on your wrath. You got to deal with all of these toxic emotions that are going on inside of you. It's time to detox, baby. It's time to get this stuff out of you. You've been mad and angry long enough. You've been walking in unforgiveness long enough. You've been bitter long enough. You've held that grudge long enough. How long does God have to strive with you and forgive you every day before you forgive the person that hurt you? How long does God have to continue to walk with you? How long does God have to continue to give you grace, but you won't give grace to other people? What in the world is wrong? Where did your heart become so hard at? I'm telling you that the Bible, the Word of God, goes on to say in verse 32, be kind and helpful to one another, tenderhearted, compassionate, understanding one another, forgiving one another readily and freely. Watch this. Just as God in Christ has forgiven you. This is crazy to me. He says, now don't be angry, but what you really should be doing is being kind to one another. Ain't God great? He's like, get over your anger, get over your madness, get over your wrath. In other words, I want to encourage you this day to maybe this is your opportunity to do something that you haven't done before. Maybe this is your opportunity to search your heart. Maybe this is your opportunity to give it to God. The scripture says, in the day that you hear my voice, harden not your heart. I want to encourage you to take a moment and just think about who hurt you. Think about where you were offended. Because much of your response to your hurt ends up being anger. Much of your response to those who resented you or did not accept you becomes anger. Much of your pathology of anger has everything to do with self-protection. So I want you to honestly take a moment and analyze your anger to determine whether it's a righteous indignation, which is godly. You're mad about sin in the world and mad about, you know, unholiness and unrighteousness and injustice. That honors God. But if you're holding a grudge and angry at somebody, maybe this is your opportunity to deal with that. I want you to know also that you can control your anger. Your anger doesn't have to control you. It really doesn't. Because remember, anger is a physiological response to a perceived threat or a perceived issue that may be coming to harm you. And many a times, after, you know, going through the same process over and over again, sometimes folks just get angry because it looks like you're going to do something that somebody else did to me. Maybe they're just not whole on the inside. And so that anger, watch this, that anger just overwhelms them. Proverbs 12:18 says, there is one who speaks rashly like the thrusts of a sword, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. I want you to know today that God wants to heal you, that God wants to fix that anger problem. God wants to do surgery on your heart. He wants to detox you. And one of the things about detoxification is you've got to stop nurturing that anger that's on the inside of you. If you're going to detox, that means you've got to stop taking in the toxins and you got to drink some water. Well, what is water? It's the water of the Word of God, right? It's this connectivity with your Creator. If you're going to detox, that means you got to stop putting stuff in that's going to feed that nasty stuff that's on the inside of your body. And the reality is that you have the capacity and the ability to do that. Because when you stop in a moment like this and God speaks to this place of anger that's on the inside of you, maybe God is saying, I'm here to save your life. I'm here to stop you. I'm here to not cause you to walk in rage and anger and bitterness and wrath and that be spewed out on your children. You're like, well, I hide it really good around my children. No, you don't. Children can perceive your anger because when you're angry, you can't walk in true love. When you're angry, you can't express the love of Jesus. When you're angry, even though you may be trying to hide it, come on, there's something that is hindering you. Remember, anger lies in the heart of a fool. And how can a fool love? Because a fool is bound by his own anger and that which is in his soul. And so it comes out in other ways. Daddy, get out of the room. I'm busy right now. Mommy, I ain't got time for you right now. And what happens is that anger then pours out. Because the thing about anger, it always needs a release. And it's never really released. It's never really released at the time you want to. You know why? Because you're not thinking rationally. Remember, your cerebral cortex has been flipped. And you're moving from your emotions, baby. That's why you got to detox. See, because this thing, if you're not careful, it will mess you up. Not only for now, but many a times you hurl words and things on people that ends up messing them up for a long time. Last but not least, you got to recognize and confess that sinful anger and submit to God's sovereign hand in the situation. See, if you're angry, you know you're angry. Angry birds, you know, you just shot them. And they just went and destroyed something. Angry words. You know if angry words have left your mouth. Because wherever there are angry words, there is destruction. Wherever angry words have left the mouth of an individual, a human being, because watch this, you got to guard your heart because out of your heart, Proverbs tells us, flows what? The issues of life. And so many a times the words that you spew are issues that are in your heart. And the reality is you got to identify what's going on in your heart. And then, come on, you've got to confess it to God. And I'm so glad for 1 John chapter 2 says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. But the idea is confession, and confession just means agreement. I'm agreeing with you, God, that you're right and I'm wrong. Me walking in this anger and in this rage and in this wrath is not doing anybody any good. It doesn't bring forth the righteousness. It is my prayer today that somebody out there, watch this, submits that anger to God, casts your care upon him because he cares for you, and says, God, I don't want this anger anymore. Forgive me. Take this away, God. I lay it at your feet. I want to tell you today that the scripture in Ephesians 4 is so rich with truth and revelation that it may even challenge you to maybe even go make it right with somebody that you have been out of relationship with, out of anger for how you were treated, or maybe out of anger on how you treated somebody, or maybe you thought you weren't treated fairly. Regardless, let God work on your heart today. Let God get the glory, right? Because that's what the scripture is talking about. And so I encourage you today to let God in the name of Jesus. Come on, let me just have a word of prayer with you. Father, I thank you that we can take moments, drink from your fountain, the water of the word, and begin to detox our hearts. Somebody today, Lord, is just mad, just angry. It's carrying that anger, and they got angry words. And those angry words are coming out of a heart that is hurt. And that hurting heart many a times causes people to spew out stuff that is not of you. I ask in the name of Jesus that you would do, God, what only you can do. Heal the heart of your people in the name of Jesus. Remind us that we don't want to give the devil a foothold, but we rather walk in grace. And that our words edify. And Lord, if there be anybody out there today who doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, I pray, God, that you would save them, bring them into the kingdom. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, touch somebody's heart to remind them that you are the God of love and the God of mercy. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Hey, listen, if you want to be saved, you can give us a call. You can text the numbers that you're going to see on the screen here. We want to connect with you. We want to invite you into the kingdom of God, that God may reach your heart, that he may speak life to you, that he may save you from your sin and forgive you and cause you to be a child of God. Last but not least, if you're not a church member, we'd love to have you in our online community until the Lord brings us back into the building again. But until then, you can participate on the Shiloh online community. This is a community of wonderful people of God who connect in many different ways. So we hope and pray that you will continue to tune in with us. You can catch us on Wednesday night. We're doing an exciting Bible study on the book of Romans. We'll be covering Romans chapter 5 this Wednesday night. So we pray the blessings of the Lord on you, and we pray God cover you. Listen, until next time, grace and peace. May God bless you and heaven smile upon you.